You've probably seen at one point or other crest or coat of arms. It belongs to a different pope or bishop or diocese. Each one of these coat of arms has particular symbols that apply to that region of the church, excuse me, or that particular pope or bishop, things about their personal life. And if you've seen the coat of arms for Pope Benedict the 16th, on his coat of arms there's a red and yellow hue pointing to his Bavarian heritage, but there's a shell, there's a seashell on his coat of arms. Now very often this seashell is mistaken as the symbol of the Camino de Santiago. If you've heard of the Way of St. James, a pilgrimage through the Spanish peninsula where St. James traditionally is understood to have gone to proclaim the gospel, that the symbol of that pilgrimage is a seashell. But the seashell on Pope Benedict's crest is not that. It's actually from a different story. And it's connected to a story of St. Augustine. As St. Augustine was working on his treatise on the Trinity, the De Trinitate, he's reflecting on this mystery of who God is. He finds himself one day walking along the shore of the sea. And he encounters on the beach what he thinks is a little boy. And he sees this little boy with a seashell scooping up water from the ocean and pouring it into a little hole that he's dug in the sand. As Augustine looks down at this boy, he asks him, what are you doing? And the boy says, I'm trying to fit the ocean into this hole. Augustine sort of chuckles a little bit to himself, and he says, well, little boy, you know that's impossible. And then with the little boy's response, Augustine realized very quickly this wasn't a little boy, but actually an angel that was sent to speak to him, because the little boy said, well, why are you trying to fit the mystery of God into a single book? And Augustine, of course, humbled in this moment by this incredible feat that he set out to do. Now, it's not to say that we shouldn't pursue knowledge of the living God, but really this seashell that Pope Benedict chose for his crest is a sign of the humility that we're invited to have, the awe and wonder that we're invited to have before the living God. That is, as we can certainly come to know the Lord, we can certainly come to know Jesus Christ, we also recognize there is always more. We can never exhaust our knowledge of who He is. What we see in today's gospel is the opposite of this. That is, as Jesus returns with His disciples to His native place, these people think they know exactly who Jesus is. And this is why they take offense at Him. They say, isn't this the carpenter's son? He's the son of Mary. We know his cousins. We know his family members. We know exactly who this is. What in the world is he doing here? And what happens from this place of pride, out of this place of an intellectual pride, thinking they've got it totally figured out, is that no mighty deed happens in their midst. We're told that Jesus is only able to heal a few sick people in that town. And he's even amazed at their lack of faith. He's amazed at their lack of faith. This should stand as a warning to us that we should never think we've got it all figured out. We should never think that I'm in a place where I know Jesus perfectly and I know exactly who he is and I've got nothing else to worry about. Because what do we risk by stepping into that place is we risk thwarting the work of God in our lives and hearts and in the hearts and lives of the people around us. That is, this pride, this lack of faith, prevents the Lord from actually working in their midst. Rather, if we approach the Lord from a place of humility, and again, it's not to say we can't actually know Him. We can come to know Jesus Christ. We can come to know the living God. But if we approach it in this place of humility and awe and wonder, recognizing that there is always more, we will be fascinated as we actually discover that more. St. John of the Cross, one of the great Carmelite saints, he described this reality as a vast cavern, a massive cave. And he said, in every nook and cranny in this cave, there's different precious jewels, there's gold, there's silver, there's precious metals. And he says, and you can spend a whole lifetime exploring just one corner, and you won't even exhaust that one corner. He says, this is the mystery of who Jesus Christ is as God made man. That we can spend a lifetime seeking to explore and mine these treasures, these gifts, and we will never exhaust the goodness of who He is. We will never exhaust the goodness of who He is. If we as a parish talk about being a community of spirit-filled missionary disciples of Jesus, part of being a disciple of Jesus, this word disciple literally means that I'm able to be taught. I'm ready to receive. I recognize that as a disciple of the Lord, I'm seeking to follow Him. I'm seeking to be in relationship with Him. But I recognize that there is always more. And this is why we've continued to pray this prayer for missionary disciples at the end of the petitions. I realize we've been doing it for a few years now. Some of us are probably tired of it. It's easy to get into the motions of just, oh, yeah, I already know this prayer, so we're just going to say it from memory and not really pay attention to the words that we're speaking. But we're actually praying something very profound. We're asking the Father, by the power of the Holy Spirit, to teach us how to actually hear Jesus, how to love Jesus, and how to go forth and actually make Him known, how to witness boldly to who He is, recognizing that while we might be doing this already, we can always improve. That is, there is always more. There is always more that the Lord has for us. And we should very much be on guard against any place of spiritual or intellectual pride in our lives that wants to reduce Jesus to someone that we know everything there is to know about Him. Rather, we want to approach with humility, with awe and wonder, this mystery of relationship with the living God, recognizing that there is always more that we can discover. There is always more that we can come to know, encountering His love and His goodness in deeper ways. And the incredible thing is that as we come to know His love in deeper ways, it can vastly change our experience of reality. And this is what we see with St. Paul in today's second reading. He says something that's crazy. He says, I boast of my weakness. I boast of my weakness, because it is when I am weak that then I am strong. We might say, that makes no sense at all. How in the world is it that when you're weak, then you are strong? But St. Paul, out of this place of deep security in the love of Jesus Christ, out of this place of a deep knowledge of who Jesus is, as he encounters his own weakness, as he encounters this, what he describes as a thorn in the flesh, and it isn't quite clear what this is, whether it's some physical ailment or some place of struggle, maybe a moral struggle, but whatever this is, as he's crying out to the Lord, he actually hears Jesus speak back to him. He says, the Lord said to me, my grace is sufficient for you because my power is made perfect in weakness. And what a profound paradox, what a profound mystery this is. But there's a reality here that St. Paul actually knows what the Lord's voice sounds like. So that when the Lord speaks to him, he recognizes it and is able to actually receive and respond to that word. And the Lord desires this for each and every one of us, that we would be in that place of deep, intimate relationship with Him, seeking to mine this deep cavern that is Jesus Christ. There's a few simple things we can do to enter more deeply into that relationship. And of course, the first is just simply to repent of any places where maybe we have given into that intellectual or spiritual pride, thinking, I've got it all figured out. I know exactly who the Lord is. We can say, Lord, I repent of this. I come before you in humility. I ask, Lord, for the grace of awe and wonder at the mystery of who you are. And just as in any relationship where we want to get to know someone, we have to spend time with them. And so we can be doing two very simple things. I know we keep coming back to these over and over. I've talked about these several times now in homilies over the course of the last 2 years. And the reason that we keep coming back to these is because they're so foundational for the Christian life. And the first is just simply to be spending time every single day with Jesus in prayer. To be taking time to worship Him, to be taking time in silence, just to speak to Him from the depths of our hearts. If we want to get to know Him, if we want to grow in relationship with Him, we have to be spending time with Him. And of course, the other thing that's very much connected to that reality is spending time every day with the Word of God. Spending time every day with the Scriptures. St. Jerome says very clearly, ignorance of the scriptures is ignorance of Christ. If we do not know the Word of God, we are not getting to know Jesus Christ. And we're offered such a beautiful opportunity in this year that our bishop, our local pastor, has called for a year of the Bible. And they're actually still doing this. They're sending out text blasts, email blasts every single day with chapters of the scriptures to be reading. And sometimes I get the text message early in the morning and it actually wakes me up, which isn't a bad thing. It's like I get woken up and reminded I need to spend some time with the scriptures today. I encourage you, if you haven't signed up for that, if you're looking for some way to start, that's a great place to go. We can just simply pick one of the Gospels and just spend time reading even just a chapter every day. As we get to know Jesus, as we get to spend time with the Scriptures, we can begin to experience, like St. Paul, what does his voice actually sound like? When he speaks, what does he sound like? When he interacts with a poor person in the Gospels, what does he do? When he encounters somebody that's very broken, a sinful person, that's an outcast in society, how does he react to that person? What does he do to that person? It's out of this place that we can recognize there is always more. We can always grow in our relationship with Jesus Christ. And if we as a community of disciples of him recognize our own humility before this mystery of who he is, we can be asking him over and over again, Jesus, take me deeper. Lord, I want to know you more. I want to love you more. I want to discover the more that you have for me. My brothers and sisters, as we enter in, as we recognize our humility, our littleness before this mystery, we can boldly proclaim, like St. Paul, of our weakness. We can boast of our weakness, recognizing that it is in our weakness, in our littleness, that God's power might shine forth.